Hi, I'm Annabel Gonzalez, non-resident senior fellow at the Peterson Institute for International Economics. And I am very pleased to welcome you and welcome you back to TradeWinds, our virtual event series, where we discuss the future of global trade in the era of the pandemic with leading policymakers and experts from across the world. Our audience, which comes from 87 countries and counting, is also a great part of our program. And I want to thank them all for being here with us, and in particular, those of you who are joining us from South Asia today. So this is our episode number 13 of TradeWinds, and today is India's turn. We will discuss what trade policy strategy for India, a topic that is of great relevance given India's important role in global trade governance and its trade and investment potential. So to lead our conversation, I am honored to have with us two great economists who have worked on India from the perspective of government, international organizations, and academia. Let me first introduce Dr. Arvind Subramanian, a non-resident senior fellow at the Peterson Institute, who is currently a professor at Ashoka University and director of the Ashoka Center for Economic Policy. Prior to that, Dr. Subramanian served as the chief economic advisor to the government of India from 2014 to 2018 and a senior fellow at the Peterson. He has written extensively on growth, on trade, development, aid, India, Africa, and the WTO, among others. And he has also worked for the IMF, the GATT, and at other distinguished universities as well. And I'm constrained by time to list all of Arvind's achievements. So Arvind is joined by an equally outstanding fellow, Dr. Harsha Vardhana Singh. Dr. Singh is chairman, IKDHVAJ Advisors, a consulting firm working on trade, industrial policy, and regulatory issues. He is a member of high-level expert groups in India and abroad that address trade, industrial, and competition policies. Earlier, he worked at the GATT and the WTO for 20 years, 8 of them as Deputy Director General of the WTO, as Secretary of India's Telecom Regulatory Authority, and Executive Director of Brookings India, among other distinguished occupations. And I have to confess that I have tasted some of the best Indian food in Harsha's house. So welcome to both of you, and thank you very much for being here at TradeWinds. And I will turn to Harsha and Arvind in a moment. Let me just remind our audience, as usual, to please get ready to submit your questions using the Q&A feature in the platform, and we will try to get to as many of them as possible. And I'd like to say a few remarks to set the context of our discussion. In 2019, India became the world's fifth largest economy, overtaking the United Kingdom and France. And this is a major achievement, but India has larger ambitions. It aspires to become a $5 trillion economy by 2025. Its participation in global trade, while growing, is still low. Moreover, calls for India to turn inward are increasing in the context of the COVID-19 pandemic and maybe from before. Nirmala Sitharaman, India's finance minister, was cited in the FT yesterday saying that current policies are helping India move closer to Atmanirbhar Bharat, or self-reliant India. Now, India has many opportunities to benefit from an enhanced participation in the world economy. According to a recent OECD report, India performs extremely well in exporting IT services, pharmaceuticals, and petroleum products. It has also a large diaspora that is well integrated abroad, helping to develop new market export markets and facilitating the transfer of technology and know-how. But India could perform better in some domains, including in labor-intensive manufacturing exports such as apparel and footwear. Now, current policies have proven insufficient to improve India's trade performance, a key goal of India's foreign trade policy strategy from 2015 to 2020. And in a recent Peterson Institute publication entitled A Worried Partnership, Future of U.S.-India Economic Relations, edited by Arvind and by Yu-Ying Yong and Stephen Weissman, several of our Peterson colleagues examine in detail India's policies and the challenges they confront, And let me give you two examples. In June 2019, the US terminated India's participation in a system that granted unilateral preferential access to Indian products in the US market. The two countries set out to reach a modest mini deal to reciprocally improve market access. And despite the fact that the US is India's main trading partner, that the accord would be very limited in scope, and that there is broader political alignment between the two governments, agreement is unlikely, as explained by Yuyin Yang in this publication. Second example is that while OECD simulations suggest that India would be a major beneficiary where barriers to trade and investment be reduced multilaterally, India often blocks major negotiations in the WTO. And in assessing India's role in the organization, my colleague Jeff Schott concludes that while India has been a prominent player, its focus has been mostly on maintaining its own flexibility to restrict imports, use domestic and export subsidies, and impose trade remedies. So these policies have harmed India's export competitiveness, and they've also constrained its ability to persuade trading partners like the US, the EU, and others to eliminate barriers to Indian exports of goods and services, hampering growth prospects. So let me now turn over to you, Arvind. You recently wrote another paper, which was cited yesterday in the FT precisely, on the topic, India's inward return. Is it warranted and will it work? And you address here the question of whether India should follow an outward or inward orientation more broadly in its development model. So in light of the globalization backlash in advanced economies and India's large domestic market, let me ask you, do you think India should rely on trade to reach its high growth ambitions?
Annabelle, thanks very much for having me on this fantastic program that you do, Trade Wins. Great to be here. Yeah, so I think the question, that's a question, by the way, Annabelle, that many countries are asking themselves in a kind of post-COVID, post-global financial crisis world, where the world is kind of generally, as you said, there's a backlash against globalization. So India has been having this, you know, kind of soul searching on a trade strategy more broadly. But in a sense, I think it's come to a kind of policy consensus internally. And this, as you quite rightly said, it preceded COVID. And that kind of a thing is a self-reliance. But I think for our viewers, I think it's worth emphasizing the distinction between self-reliance as a macro strategy and self-reliance as a trade strategy. And they both go together. So the consensus, or the growing evolving consensus in India, is that we need to, you know, focus on domestic demand, you know, consumption, investment, as opposed to exports. On the macro side and on the trade side, we need to, you know, erect barriers, you know, encourage domestic import substitution. And it's not that, you know, exports are neglected, but it's felt that the way to, you know, even achieve export growth is to, you know, do this import substitution first as a way of going back into some kind of export strategy. The problem with this is kind of a little bit ironic, which is that one of the most stunning findings that we came to in this research that we did, you know, for the Peterson and others, is that for the last 30 years, India has been a kind of East Asian tiger, not just in terms of exports of services, but in terms of exports of manufacturing. India has been the third fastest grower in manufacturing exports over three decades. And so the question is, why would you, you know, why kill the golden goose that's been laying the golden eggs for so long? You know, if it ain't broke, why fix it? So that's kind of a little bit of a paradox here, why India is doing that. So, you know, just that research shows that, you know, if you look at our historical experience, periods of rapid export growth coincide with rapid overall growth. And so why should we turn away from that at this point? Now, I think one has to take seriously the arguments for, you know, why one should, you know, move away from that strategy, because many countries in the world are doing that. You know, China most famously, you know, they're kind of saying we want to turn inward as well. And the US has been, you know, a protectionist. You know, so it's not India is not unique that way. But I think what we find is that all the arguments for turning inward, you know, I think there's a sense in India, now India is a big economy, therefore, you know, domestic markets, at least don't pay a huge cost for ignoring overseas markets because you have a domestic market. Second, I think there is a sense that, you know, the world is going to deglobalize, export opportunities are going to decline. So, you know, even if you wanted to, the world is going to be a very, not a very unfriendly place for exports. I think what we say is that all these arguments are misplaced, that we should go back to an export-led strategy. And that export-led strategy requires openness, not to become closed broadly, especially in this area of low-skill manufacturing exports. The other kind of little bit of a stunning statistic that we find is that if you compare India's share of the global labor force and how much labor skill exports it has, we've estimated that, you know, India is underperforming like somewhere between $60 and $150 billion annually. So that's the big opportunity, you know, low skill exports. But for that, you need more openness, not less openness. You know, you need to import a lot. You know, you know, if you want to export man-made fiber, you need to import yarn. And then India has turned protectionist. So I think that just to wrap up, despite the world becoming a little bit unfriendly, I think India should continue to, you know, use exports. But remember that, you know, this export strategy will require more, not less, openness, especially if it's to exploit the underexploited opportunities in unskilled labor exports. Just one last point, which we'll come to later, is that this then feeds into India's broader strategy on, you know, the new Asian financial architecture and global engagement as well. We'll come to that later, but I think one needs to understand that domestic policy in India is unfortunately turning inward, flying in the face of our own experience of the last 20, 30 years.
Hmm. All right, thank you. Thank you very much, Arvind, for those remarks. Let me now turn over to you, Harsha. You've been working on these issues for quite some time now. And I'd like to ask you, what are some of the opportunities that you see for India in the global economy? Should the country move to improve its trade policies? And in particular, how do you think India could attract more foreign direct investment?
Thank you. Thank you very much, Annabelle. And it's a great pleasure to be part of this very good program which you run. The question you've asked also overlaps with what Arvind has just answered. And I both partly agree with Arvind and partly have a different view on the point which Arvind has come up with. And I'll explain why. One, trade policy today is not just trade policy at the border. So when one talks about opening up, one talks about border measures being less restrictive, more facilitative, etc. And I see the value of that. I agree with that. That is one part of opening up trade policy. Trade policy is also now inside the border, which is which overlaps in a major way with domestic policy. The peculiarity of the Indian regime was that it was actually reducing restrictions and being facilitative inside the border and focusing on restrictions at the border, especially in the last few years. This stance was announced in the budget of India in 2018, that the finance minister said, now I'm changing the policy we have followed till now, and I will actually impose tariffs to promote domestic industry. So that is a combination which was happening. The change which has happened in the current situation is that it, as in all matters in India, It's a combination of objectives which have started expressing themselves. The so-called inward-looking policy is actually a combination of trying to understand what has worked in other countries which are outpacing India in global trade. The trade share, the merchandise trade share, according to WTO statistics, increased from about 0.7% in 2000 to 1.7% in 2011. And since 2011, it has stayed around 1.7%. Two particular years, it was 1.6%. And the trade deficit is something which worries India. It's also projected its demand for products such as electronics, etc., and tries to see what will be the impact on its own position vis-a-vis the foreign exchange. Therefore, looking at the experience of other countries, in particular Vietnam, Bangladesh, China, etc., they came to the conclusion that they need to connect with global value chains. In order to do that, they need to be in touch with lead firms and get those lead firms to establish their businesses in India at a large scale. This was at a time when discussions were happening with China plus one, and the lead firms were being wooed by every country in the region, each and every country. And all of them try to give the kind of incentives which India has looked at and emulated some of them. At the same time of the lead firms coming in, the lead firms really have a large impact domestically through development of domestic ecosystems where domestic entrepreneurs come up. And this is part of the new industrial policy approach of India. It also saw that lead firms would find it more attractive to come, both a combination of domestic market and the export opportunities, because tariffs on inputs are remitted once you export. If they provide some protectionist so-called incentives through higher tariffs, that is the kind of mindset which has come up. The problem, as I see it, is as follows. At one level, this is copying what some of the successful countries in global trade who have increased their positions quite rapidly have done. At another level, it's precisely inside the border policies also, which get impacted by the border policy mentality. So once you bring an approach to trade policy that I must restrict XYZ, the systemic impact of that is far wider than just the narrow focus which you want, even if it is only for 3 or 5 years. Ideally, it has to be managed in such a way that the kind of support you give has to be managed with openness at the border also, especially openness for facilitating the links with the global value chains. That's one part which is missed in this entire thing. The other part is that the facilitation, etc., which, and India has established its own, like the World Trade Organization requires that. The facilitation is focused on by a National Trade Facilitation Committee in a very collaborative, cooperative manner, where specific problems are looked at and effort is made to address them. However, in policy in general, even if we come up with good policies, my research has shown something which we have done, I've done as a team with some other experts, that there is a problem in the implementation part. There is a problem in the overall coordination part. And global value chains, by definition, are not the realm of any single administrative agency or ministry. So it's the implementation part makes it even worse, where the good effect doesn't come in and the bad effect of restriction at the border stays. So that's the kind of problem as I see at present. But the policy, which some of which are being cast as as inward looking are exactly the policies which the so-called outward technology products. India actually is a player in a number of higher technology products, or has the potential to do so. The techniques underlying these studies include demand supply elasticities of as conducted by the ITC in Geneva, include product space analysis, etc. So the list of products is quite large, but if you are addressing such a horizontal coverage, the policy should also be one of horizontal coverage. In the sense, it should be facilitative. It should provide the kind of incentives which are positive to increase the thrust of investment and business there. And it's the emphasis on ease of doing business, facilitation, and also a focus on what are the investors looking at. So India is also trying to do that. Those are the kind of policies which India would like to implement to increase investment in India. FDI, in fact, even in COVID times in the last 3 months, has increased more than it did last year in the corresponding period. So investors are looking at India, but the change in India right now, especially because there's lack of clarity on which of these two forces which India needs to look at, is it the connection with GVCs, or is it trying to close the markets, which a self-reliant India normally projects a picture of, which one of these is going to prevail? And if there has to be a balance, what is the nature of balance you want, so that the negative factors really are tapered out and the positive impact comes up? So that, in summary, is as I see it, is a complex situation. It's not a very clear issue, but a complex situation which needs to be addressed, and addressed by enhancing the positive impacts, many of which Arvind talked about. And the factors which actually resulted in increase in exports in Bangladesh, Vietnam, etc., are far more than just open policies. It was active industrial policy, which looked at scale, which looked at technology, which looked at standards, so it's a package of things. And when you manage such a package of issues, you actually have to have very efficient implementation. And that in India still needs to go some way. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Harsha, for your introductory remarks as well. I want to move now to bring up some questions on India's trade policy in particular, because we're talking here about different elements, all of which are important. But I think you mentioned, both you and Arvind have mentioned, the importance of openness at the border to facilitate links with value chains and to realize the potential of exports in manufacturing, be it low-skill manufacturing, or, as you were saying, Harsha, maybe higher-skilled manufacturing as well. And I have several questions for you, but maybe the first one refers to RCEP, because this is, of course, an issue that we have seen very much in the papers since November 15, when ASEAN 10 plus Australia, China, Japan, New Zealand, and South Korea signed the Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership, creating the world's largest economic bloc. And RCEP may be incomplete in some areas, but I think that there is a consensus that one important benefit of RCEP is that it will facilitate the operation of supply chains in the region. And India, which had been a participant in the negotiations, dropped out in November last year, allegedly over fears of competition from China in industrial goods, or maybe Australia in agricultural products. And the door has been left for India to join the agreement. What are your views, and maybe let me start with you, Arvind, what are your views on India's participation in RCEP, and do you think India should join this agreement?
Okay. I want to make three or four points on RPEP. First, I think one has to understand that unlike many other countries, including, for example, Mexico when it joined the GATT or China when it joined the WTO, they used the external anchor, the WTO, to facilitate domestic reforms. That was a key part of strategy. In India, rarely, if at all, ever does that. India, external policy is driven by domestic policy, then vice versa. So the notion that, you should join RCEP in order to, facilitate domestic reform is not, never features high on policymakers' minds. So the question of whether we should join RCEP is a little bit cart before the horse. If domestically you've decided to turn more protectionist, more industrial policy, then it's going to be, very difficult to say, I go inward domestically, but I want to join RCEP. So I think one has to resolve India's domestic, what is going to be the development strategy domestically, and that will then feed into, whether or not to join RCEP. So that's point number one. Point number two is that, I think there are two or three things about RCEP that we need to understand, because remember, RCEP, as we know in all these things at the Peterson Institute, is that trade policy is not just trade policy. It's about strategic policy, foreign policy, domestic politics, a lot of things feed in. Now, with RCEP, I think one has to understand that for India, China looms large as RCEP, right? So almost de facto, it's going to be like an India-China free trade agreement, because, India has FTAs with most other countries, not Australia and New Zealand. So it will be like opening up to China big time. Now, I have some kind of sympathy for India's wariness on that for two or three reasons. One, India has been running a high and rising trade deficit with China. And the pattern of trade is very colonial. India exports raw materials and imports finished goods. For example, in the domestic consciousness, the fact that idols of Hindu gods are coming from China drives people nuts in India. How can we have Ganesha idols coming from China? This great Indian civilization can't manufacture its own idols. Of course, it's heresy in the Peterson Institute to talk about bilateral trade deficits, but this does color the overall approach to, the anxiety, the wariness, the underconfidence. That's one. Second, I think there is a genuine fear that, China pursues all kinds of policies which doesn't create a level playing field, whether the exchange rate, whether subsidies, whether de facto non-tariff barriers. And what is the, can RCEP in any way guarantee that there will be a level playing field? And the answer has to be in the negative, because after all, the US has tried to do it, Europe has tried to do it, the WTO has tried to do it, and successful. So I think the fact that there's a big trade deficit, the fact that, you have no control over, whether it's going to be a level playing field and whether you're going to be flooded with imports, colors that. And of course, then there's the whole, Chinese aggression in the Himalayas, which I think has also, and if anything, India has taken a number of trade policy actions, not just trade, but also, banning apps, restricting Chinese FDI. So that's the overall context for India joining RCEP. So, of course, not joining RCEP will have costs. There will be, not integrating with value chains. I think the whole India will get, export competed out because others are coming close together. But there are these other bigger things going on. So in an ideal world, I think given all that, Harsha has said, and you have said, in an ideal world, promoting exports would, mean that joining RCEP would be a good thing. But I think in this broader context where India has turned inward, where large, where you can't create level playing field. I think, you know, I would hesitate to say strongly, oh, this was a bad decision, because, you know, there's so much going on. I would rather not second guess. Hopefully over time, I think when some of these things are resolved, I mean, if, for example, it turns out that China plays by the rules, if, for example, India, the Chinese-Indian situation improves, if, you know, India itself realizes that, you know, it can compete in international markets, maybe a few years down the line, India can, you know, reassess this option.
All right. Thank you. Thank you very much, Arvind. Harsha, what is your take on RCEP?
Thank you very much. I agree entirely with the points which Arvind has emphasized. Let me just clarify one thing, that for India to decide not to join RCEP was not a decision it took without a lot of thought. In fact, the pros and cons were evaluated even till the last minute. The Prime Minister of India attended the meeting, and then a decision point was reached where decision was made not to join RCEP for five declared reasons. One was that India was pressing for something like a special safeguard mechanism in agriculture in the Doha round, where with very large volume of imports from China, especially China, it was in dairy, it was Australia and New Zealand also, but I think a solution for dairy was within reach. But this concern of exports from China, which are a result of policies which are not really those which are thought of when you think of a level playing field, as Arvind has emphasized. And this is something which the major economies in the world are today grappling with. If there is a large surge of imports, they wanted some kind of a snapback mechanism, something which the US had negotiated with Japan in automobiles, for example. Something where, but slightly more urgently implemented than the snapback as negotiated in TPP. So one was a China issue. The second was a combination of China issue and the experience with FTAs. What they had seen was the FTAs in their mind were resulting in circumvention of what was agreed. So, for example, the Chinese products, because of the rules of origin, going to another country, another member country, and coming to India from there, as if it was produced there. But of course, the accumulated rules of origin made it very difficult to say no. So they wanted a credible rule of origin mechanism, which would address circumvention. This is a major concern in the US also, incidentally. US now implements anti-circumvention in a very active manner in its contingent policy. Another was establishing a credible mechanism to address non-tariff measures. Because when it analyzed its FTAs with the East Asian economies and the trade restrictions which were there, the tariffs were relatively low, but the non-tariff measures were seen as very debilitating for Indian exports to these countries. So the concern domestically was the large trade deficit which was developing, which built up the base for arguments against an FTA, so to say, for India. Mm-hmm. And this is something which, again, in CPTPP, they have a mechanism in Article 2.9.2, where whether it's border restriction or non-tariff measure, you have a remedy which can be quickly provided to you. So that kind of mechanism was missing. They wanted certain service sectors to be opened up for opening their economy. Mm. And that the tariffs which they had increased since 2014 not be the base point for reduction to zero, but the 2019. So they wanted some breathing space there. The China issue and the circumvention issue is the largest of this all. Yeah. Till that changes, it becomes extremely difficult for India to connect with an FTA where the China problem will be very palpable. And Arvind rightly pointed out, China is the example of one country I know where they actually use the external disciplines negotiated in their accession to WTO as domestic reform. Most other countries, either the large players initially, EU and US, either took their domestic policies and took it to the WTO or GATT earlier and made it multilateral policy so that the world operated using those policies, or the domestic forces color their participation in a trade agreement, multilateral or plurilateral. India is very much in that boat. So I don't think that the concerns which India based its decision on are not substantive. The domestic position is such that till these concerns are addressed, I don't think the politics of the situation will allow a decision to change. However, India still needs to play in the global markets. That's where this other focus on global value chains, large investments coming in specified sectors, as had been done in other competing economies, that's where that policy comes from. But that policy also has the baggage of the aspects which are restrictive and become obstacles.
Follow up on that? You see, I think we should also be aware of the fact that not joining is going to entail costs, right, for India. It's not that it's costless, as Harsha also said, and as Indian policymakers. The reason why at this point of time, maybe it is a high cost, I'm still not saying the decision was right or wrong, is that notice that part of the Indian industrial policy strategy today, you know, what Harsha referred to, the behind the border measures, you know, the production incentives, the subsidies that India is kind of rolling out, it is based on this idea that, you know, China has been becoming more and more uncompetitive as it's becoming richer. So that's what happened post-global financial crisis. That was the first exit out of China. And now there's a second possible exit out of China for all kinds of geopolitical reasons, you know, whatever. So it's that combination that's created this huge opportunity for all those countries, you know, in Asia, wanting to attract this FDI that, you know, in order to be part of, you know, the global market, as Harsha said. So, but at this juncture, if that is the objective, firms then, you know, will say, aha, should I go to a country that's not part of RCEP? Or should I go to a country that's part of RCEP? You know, so that's going to be the kind of little bit of a cost, additional cost that India will pay, and maybe the subsidies. So that's why, you know, just to little bit switch gears, I think the way for India to kind of square this circle is to say, look, we're not turning inward, you know, whatever, we still want to be part of the global chain. But in fact, for India to be, this is my strong view, to consider, you know, FTAs with, say, the European Union, where I think there's a very compelling logic because, you know, tariffs on apparel, et cetera, are still high. And India has a non-level playing field compared to Bangladesh and Vietnam, which have more preferential access into EU markets. And that is where, you know, if India really wanted to signal that it still wants to play the global game, it wants to exploit its opportunities in these low-skill intensive sectors, maybe, you know, almost as a kind of signal that, you know, RCEP was not because of turning inward in a broader sense, but had to do with China and all these strategic reasons. Maybe that's what that's a kind of option that India might want to seriously consider.
Now, it's interesting. Just let me just bring this element here of the maybe possibility of negotiating an EU-India FTA, because we know that these negotiations were launched in 27. They were suspended in 2013. In the meantime, the EU has moved, as you rightly were pointing out, Arvind, to negotiate, for instance, with Vietnam. So and many other countries, because the EU has actually taken a very proactive policy on FTA negotiation. So is there a real possibility for India to engage, re-engage in this negotiation? We have a viewer, a participant, who is precisely asking asking about that, and Noel Klihain, and he says that recent high-level dialogues with the EU suggest that, you know, prospects are encouraging. What is your view on this? And Harsha, maybe you can come in.
Thank you very much.
Yeah.
Yeah. Just a quick word on add to what Arvind said, that actually India is trying to give the picture that it wants to connect with the global value chains and be an active part of it. The prime minister, the ministers, etc., are doing it. On attracting investment, what we have to remember, behind the border policies are largely policies run by individual provinces or states of India.
Yeah.
And a number of states are very active in that regard. And the I haven't seen the report of the latest finance commission, which was submitted to the government of India. But one part of that was also to try and incentivize states to enable the system which will increase export capabilities from those states. So it, the Finance Commission focuses on a lot of other larger issues of development, but this was also a part of that from what I recall from some reports. So India is trying to do that, but at the same time, India is also doing some other things. And India has to improve the efficiency of all the good things which it is implementing, and the bad things themselves are a drag, irrespective of whether you implement it properly or not. So that is the combination. On EU, actually, India-EU discussions, from the feedback I've got, including from those who are negotiating that, is that solutions were very much within reach. There were solutions on issues of wine, cheese, auto components, etc. Finance was financial services was also one consideration within that context, which was creating problems. They were actually within reach. We could have had solutions to the EU-India bilateral agreement, trade and investment agreement, if these were the only issues. Then came the issues of data. And as far as data is concerned, data security was being negotiated. Data privacy was not yet an issue, but data security and privacy issues became the largest stumbling block for two reasons. One, in EU, US themselves were discussing it, and there were problems in what they had negotiated together. And then the Indian system had a high-level committee which started looking at this. And the conclusions were such that they created larger distance than what existed at the time of the agreement not coming together. The India-EU agreement can come together, and I completely agree with Arvind. In fact, we had calculated the disabilities faced by India vis-a-vis, say, Bangladesh, Vietnam, or China in exporting apparel or textiles. And it was the one thing which hits India very much with Bangladesh is the 9.2% or 8.2% tariff faced by products from India, while 0% tariffs from Bangladesh and incrementally from Vietnam also for textiles and apparel. In addition to that, there's about a 10% disadvantage due to the kind of policies they follow compared to the kind of policies which India followed. So that's a very large gap to cover to increase your competitiveness. And one large jump would be to have this FTA. Mm-hmm. My approach to this would be that whatever is a difficult issue, it is not only one part of the issue, which say data issues or digital issues is not just one part. You can aggregate certain aspects of the problem or the area of negotiation where you actually think the same way and clinch that as early harvest and keep working on solutions in such a way that the cost of not reaching comfort zone where you have a mutually satisfactory solution, which I call as manageable discomfort, taking the larger benefits into account. That is what we need to do. And it's possible to do so, but let's have some early harvest to energize the thing. And yes.
Go ahead. Annabel, very quickly, I think the India, for all the reasons that Harsha said and you said, I think the India-EU agreement, it had progressed, when I was in government, actually, this was being actively discussed. It progressed very far. And then, and to be honest, at that point, at some point, the EU itself got distracted with having to handle, Trump's trade policy. So not all the blame is India's. I think they got distracted too. But I want to say just two things. One, the complementarities are there, and especially in the labor-intensive sectors where India is disadvantaged by this. The second, I think, why I think it makes sense now is also that, remember, trade agreements are about many other things as well. I think in this context of how the world is going to react to China, right, I think, the US and EU, as we've heard, are, kind of thinking about, opening discussions, etc. So I think there is a kind of role for India here, via free trade agreement, but more broadly, that how does the world deal with China? I think that's and so an EU FTA makes sense from a strategic point of view as well. The last point I would make here is a kind of a narrow point, is that I think the world has, because remember, going forward, the game is also going to be about whose standards are going to prevail, whether in telecom, on procurement, or data, or whatever, right? And there's jockeying going on, and China has made it absolutely clear that it wants its standards to be adopted. In fact, as part of the BRI, we see that it's forcing all these, borrowers to adopt Chinese standards. Now, is that in the global best interest? If it isn't, then I think there's an argument for, India, EU, US, EU, all of, other countries to kind of come together to also discuss, what should be the global standards? How should they be set in a way that prevents a kind of Chinese hegemony on these standards?
That's a very interesting point. Just a second, Harsha. I just want to bring in as well the question about what trade policy with the U.S. then. We know a new administration is coming in. They have basically said, no new agreements, at least in the early part of the administration. India is not benefiting from GSP anymore in the U.S. Market. So what kind of trade policy should India pursue with the new Biden administration? Harsha, you want to come in and make a point and then also tackle this
Thank you. Thank you. I'll address both. Just one part, and Arvind raised a very important issue, that if in the future the global system which we operate in has options and also certain sort of insurance policies built into it, the strategic aspect becomes very important. The problem, as I see it, is that while countries recognize the strategic significance, when trade negotiations take place, it's the brass tacks people who are completely not really connected with the strategic interests. They take over. And there is a conflict of reaching a solution which will feed the strategic interest in a manner which I talked about, where both countries give and take. So the negotiations can't be conventional negotiations. There is a larger element of that negotiation. That result has to feed into the larger strategic aspect. And
but presumably commercial interests also need to be
addressed. But the strategic interest goes beyond that. What Arvind talked about was not just strategic interest. If you are to look at standards, how the issue of Chinese presence is going to be looked at globally. And China is one example I'm taking, but strategic interests go in multiple ways. So commercial is part of strategic, but it's not the whole part of strategic. That's the point I'm making. And in trade negotiations, it becomes the whole part of the negotiation. That is the conflict as I see it. Therefore, really high level leaders have to come in and give directions so that the conclusions are made more possible. The give and take is evaluated in a coordinated manner with very high participation of the political leadership. That's one point. And that becomes relevant also for India-US. Now, India-US, the feedback I have is the reason why the agreement did not go through is not because of India. It was because US did not agree to whatever it was on the table. And what is on the table is not bad. It is actually a substantive package, which can be the base for building further and further. The way I visualize this is like a concentric circle, where you take the inner circle, get a deal, cover the next circle after that, because countries like India with the complex politics and trade related industrial policy, which is being put together, they need breathing space while going through to a larger level of obligation or engagement. And India has actually given what is perceived by many who know these negotiations, very significant solutions to the concerns which were raised by US. But if the US itself doesn't come forward, and that's what the Biden administration has to look at, combined with the strategic policy, which I talked about, and how one has to build through early harvest, larger harvest, and incrementally the relationship for trade and investment together. And that's something which I need to emphasize is required to change the manner in which trade negotiations are being conducted right now.
Annabel, on India-US, let me say, I think, you know, I don't think we should hold out any big, you know, breakthroughs on the trade front. The India-US relationship will neither, hopefully, will not be broken by trade, nor will be made by trade. You know, trade will just, you know, we have to have a holding operation because, you know, what is going to, you know, keep that relationship going are all these other issues where I think there's much more commonality, you know, than there is on trade and investment. So I think while I think we should prevent further deterioration on the trade side, but I don't think we should hold any serious hopes that they're going to be, because of both sides. Both sides are reluctant, you know, by the new administration is contemplating its own. India is turning inward, so it's not going to be easy. So let's not have too much on that. However, I think lots of things around it, I think, can be done to keep this relationship, very important strategic relationship, going. You know, one, there's the old, I'm beating a flogging a dead horse, the China thing. I think there's that commonality is always there. There's probably going to be a lot more, you know, defense cooperation, you know, purchases of military equipment. You know, that's always been a very strong component that has to keep going. I think also that, you know, some of the irritants that were imposed by Trump administration's immigration policy, you know, the H-1Bs, the students and all of that. I think those also, I think it's incumbent on the new administration to settle those issues. There are lots of frictions, you know, trade conflicts between India and China and the US, which also I think should be settled. So I think that this is a relationship, it does need a new opening, but it's not going to come about because, you know, some big breakthrough is going to happen on trade. This is a relationship that will be sustained and driven forward by all these other commonalities that US and India have. And I think the trade shouldn't kind of be a potential derailer. I think it should just kind of keep it, you know, keep the flames down, solve all the, you know, conflicts, but not expect any big breakthroughs.
This is such a rich discussion that, you know, I would like to go deeper into all of these topics, but unfortunately, we're getting closer to the end of our session. And I want both of you to refer to one additional point, which seems to be critical in the future of India's trade policy, which is the WTO, because we've seen that at the regional or bilateral level, there are some challenges, but presumably India could play an active role in reforming, revitalizing the WTO. Several of our participants, Saeed Akman, Rob Anderson, Ernesto Fernandez, are asking, so what position for India in the WTO? Harsha, you wanna come in? And mind you, we have a couple of minutes for each of you, unfortunately, because we're close to our time.
Thank you. Very, very quickly, quick point on to follow up, Arvind, which is trade policy will not be the lever which really pulls up the strategic relationship between US and India as such. But it actually has potential and possibilities which should not be left just because it is not the make or break issue. So we should build upon that. And there are multiple of those. Because of time not being there, I don't want to go into that. On WTO, I think India's participation needs to be more engaged. The problem, as I see it, is that the negotiations, for example, some of them, they don't look at the problems of India in the manner in which I've tried to show how solutions could come. For example, in the telecom sector negotiations, there was this reference paper which had a series of guidelines, and people incorporated whichever one. There were some principles to be incorporated in the schedules. They incorporated that. India did not really focus on that, but in actual practice, and I was a telecom regulator that time. Afterwards, we implemented those practices in actual fact. So once that happened and the impact was there, the possibility of going from softer law to a harder law becomes easier. And that's the approach which I see as a basis for India agreeing much more. A little bit of hard law, but also accommodation of its concerns. But at the same time, the system can't be seen only through the prism of one perspective. And India has a different perspective. There has to be a discussion on that rather than classifying one as obstructionist and the other one as building the system.
So Annabel, let me end on a slightly cynical note here, right? I think, you know, there's no question that, you know, India has to get more engaged in the WTO, et cetera, right? But two observations. One is that, you know, if India is turning inward domestically, then, you know, it's going to spill over into, if it's spilled over into RCEP, it's going to spill over into the WTO as well. So, you know, that's a reality has been covered. But I think the what might actually, and this is my cynical ending, what might, I think, kind of, you know, kind of paper over all this going forward is that, you know, the WTO itself, where is it going, is going to be depend upon, you know, much bigger forces, US, EU, China, how, what their plans they have for the WTO. So if the larger WTO negotiation of revitalizing the WTO goes nowhere, or I don't know how to, maybe it'll make some progress, but if that doesn't really take off, then, you know, Indian policy in the WTO, you know, constructionist, engaging, positive, etc., are going to become, you know, kind of not first order issues, you know, in the larger global context.
My thought is India can still contribute in that. The solutions which will be there, including the solutions which the trilateral group of EU, US, Japan are looking at for the Chinese policies, India should participate actively in that.
Well, I want to conclude also with a sort of a reflection on after listening to both of you, and thank you very much for your great remarks, which is a new Biden administration is talking about bringing democracies together to work on many of the challenges that are confronting the world today. And that presumably will mean that India not only would have a seat at the table, but will be expected also, you know, to punch according to its weight. And trade policy, while certainly not explaining the full, you know, potential of any relationship at the international level, you know, it has to be a component from that perspective, I think. And likewise, domestically, and maybe it goes to the point that Arvind was saying, well, you know, if domestic politics, of course, drive trade policy and the interaction with trading partners, maybe everyone will continue to look very closely at India and how this inward-outward discussion evolves within the country. So on that note, thank you very much, Arvind. Thank you very much, Harsha. It's been a great conversation, and we definitely need to continue this some other time, because many details that we could dwell into. So thank you very much again. Thanks to our audience for your continued participation, to my PII colleagues who make Trade Winds possible. And please stay tuned for our next episode of Trade Winds on Wednesday, December 16. We will discuss with Richard Baldwin his latest book on revitalizing the multilateral trading system. So until then, thank you very much and goodbye.